studio or her own production company and say, okay, studios, I want to play this character.
Production companies and studios and things like that. That's like the kind of things that we need so we can put ourselves, and I mean in every shade and all everybody, so we could put more shows, more people in the entertainment industry and have that representation there. Because how is it that there's like so little Latino shows?
She's already owned, though. The entertainment industry is already owned. It's like when you go, hi everybody, by the way, when you go to a nail salon, it's owned by a certain ethnic group. So the entertainment industry is already owned by a certain ethnic group. I think one of the things that I tried to put forth last time, even though it kind of became a show because of Rad Latino and myself, I'll take my responsibility for it.
Good. But that's good.
One of the things I try to put forth is we need to understand what ethnicity is, and we need to understand what our ethnicity is. If we understood that, then we would understand that we are a people. And of course, there's diversity within people, just like there's diversities within a family. But we are united people. There are bonds that tie us together, historic, genetic, cultural. And if we embrace that, then we would stop looking at, you know, the 50 to 70 million of Hispanos in the U.S. and we would look at the 600 to 700 million, depending how you want to measure them, Hispanos or Latinos across North and South America. You know, if we understood the concept of ethnicity, we would understand that we are the third biggest ethnicity on the planet after Han, Chinese, and Indians. Yet we don't function that way. We don't see things that way because we're too, looking at minuscule details as opposed to really understanding. And the problem is that we're letting American culture infiltrate our mindset and the way we view the world. So now you're adding in racial lenses that just divide us and cause tensions, when really, if we focus, we could realize that we're a multiracial, monocultural ethnicity. You know, our language binds us, our historical experience bind us. Whether we have internal gripes or not, what I would propose is that we get over that, that we try to harmonize that and we embrace both our Indian and African and Spanish roots. You know,
yeah, that's what we were talking. That's what
you know what?
I think Cuba is a good example of that.
I think that most Afro Latinos are not going to deny their Spaniard. Yeah, I would say that most.
It's not denying, but there is a rejection.
I think it's more of a
resentment.
It's not a rejection or a resentment. I think it's more of a, let's just call it for what it was, right?
Yeah, but
let's recognize what we have.
You're saying your line of critique says that what it was rape, but most of us don't even
not just that it was rape, but wouldn't I don't think that we should romanticize it because we don't romanticize our other parts of our history, and I think that there needs to be a level playing field. Like if you want to romanticize Spain, you need to romanticize our Afro and our Taino, right?
Let's romanticize them all. I mean,
but that doesn't happen.
Well, can I add?
Hold on 1 second. It's not happening. Okay, if it hasn't happened, that was yesterday. Today's a new day. Turn the page. You got a blank page. Let's start right now. You know, if we really want to move forward, we need to unpack the Black Legend, because the Black Legend was a real propaganda war. It's how France, England, and the Netherlands conducted war against Spain. And so we have an impression of our Spanish heritage that isn't necessarily historically accurate. And I'm saying, let's unpack it. Let's open up the history books. Let's look at it. And let's have a more honest and holistic understanding. Because first of all, most of us don't come from conquistadors. Most of us come from the settlers who came here and married the locals. So it's like, why do we walk around acting like we're children of rape? Like, no, you know,
I don't think that's what it is.
But that's how it's characterized.
But you know what it is? I think that some of us, like I've said before, some of us have had experiences that some other Latinos had never had. And when you live here in America, where it's a racialized country, not only that, and then our parents come from their countries, which we think that we're not racialized over there, but we have a lot of internalized racism within our own community. So when you bring that here, and you then you have all these Latinos having these different experiences, and then there's Latinos that disregard other Latinos' experiences. That's why there's no unity. You
cannot
have unity when you're saying, oh, well, you need to get over that. I'm over it, but my kids, my young teenage kids that I teach are not, because I see it every day in the way they talk.
Because they're learning history about themselves through Anglos, right? I mean, Think about it. Franco, you got to put yourself on mute, or Terrell, I don't know who. Look, the Vietnamese kids go to Vietnamese school on Saturdays. The Russian kids go to Russian school on Saturday, right? We don't have any Spano school. So these children are learning history about themselves from our historical enemies. We need to at least accept that that's going to have a bias. There's going to be a bias there.
Regardless. Of course, but also our parents don't teach us history either. We have to go out and learn it ourselves.
Because our parents don't. Okay, our parents don't know, because they come from countries that have a vested interest in making the previous regime seem bad, so that the people think, oh, you know what, maybe shit sucks, but at least it's not as bad as when Spain was around. Well, how historically accurate is that? Why don't we have the opportunity now, and we have the tools available to us to actually unpack these questions, to actually dig into the history and reassess, because the impression that Spanish bad and they did bad things to the Indians, as if the Indians didn't do bad things to each other, or the 500 Spaniards conquered Mexico City, which is a lie. The Indians conquered, right? Like that again, I said this thing last time.
You can't relate transatlantic slavery to how like indigenous people treated each other, or like African countries treated one another. It's not the same.
Let's unpack that. Wait. Let's unpack that. Are you saying that blacks in Africa didn't enslave other blacks and sold them to Jewish traders?
No.
Sold them to Spanish plantation owners?
I'm not saying that.
Let me ask you this question. Was there African-American slave owners in the United States?
I didn't say that either. That's internalized racism.
Were they? No, it wasn't internalized racism. It was an entrepreneur of his time just conducting chattel slavery as it was done. We need to stop associating slavery as a black thing. The word slave comes from Slavs. The Slavs were slaves. The English were slaves.
You can't compare that. You can't compare transatlantic slavery.
The problem is that you've been indoctrinated to this victim identity. You can't let it go.
I'm the victim when I love myself wholeheartedly, my G. And I accept myself wholeheartedly. The thing is that you cannot compare transatlantic slavery.
And you're still walking around with that gripe.
Rancho, if I may. Rancho.
Even white people have ancestors who were slaves. How come white people don't walk around with that gripe? Let me answer that question.
It's not the same thing. It's not the same thing. It is not the same thing.
I've heard you times already. Please let me.
It's totally different. They stole people.
It's not the same thing. I get it.
White people could trace their motherfucking lineage back.
There was no countries in Africa before.
It's not the same thing.
I don't think white people necessarily can trace back their history in Latin America, because it's really hard for a lot of Latin Americans.
I'm not saying Latin America. I'm saying white people here.
Oh, but the thing, but even white Latin Americans. Listen, so the
people have ancestors who were. Why don't white people walk around with a gripe on their shoulder? I'll tell you why. Because the American education system wants black people to have that gripe on their shoulders. They want them to feel resentful and bitter and confused about.
Because of the way the curriculum is built.
I let you make your point. The reason why they want to make them that way is because when you're emotional, when you're caught into emotions, you're more easily to be controlled. Okay, you can't get over the past, so you can't live in today. That's done intentionally because it neutralizes Black Americans from prospering.
Wait, so I want to make a point.
Somebody. Everybody's been a victim of somebody. I have a problem is that you're characterizing blackness with victimology.
No.
That's debilitating. No,
wait. No, I want to.
Do you adhere to critical theory? Would you say you follow critical theory?
Yeah, she's a gringa.
Critical race theory?
I mean, critical theory in general, because critical theory, race theory is one part of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, I would say that I follow it.
Yeah. Okay, so do you know where that originates from?
White
no,
people.
I don't know.
So it comes from the Frankfurt School. Do you know what the Frankfurt School, why they created critical theory?
Explain.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining us. Welcome to El Pocho Hour. I'm your host, Noel OG del Rancho. Today, we have an awesome panel as usual. Our subject for today is really getting to understand our ethnic roots. And before that, I have to really explain the difference between ethnos and race. So let me go ahead and dig into that. So a lot of people confuse these concepts. They don't, especially Americans, they don't know how to distinguish a race from an ethnicity, and they're not necessarily the same thing. When Americans think about race, they really first think about colors, primary colors, black or white. But overall, to them, it might mean like some genetic similarity, but also geographic similarity. And they're really clumping a lot of races. For example, an example of a real race could be argued is Slavic or Germanic. Right. But to say that they're both of the white race is really kind of more of a modern Anglo spin on things. So the way that Max Weber, a German ethnosociologist, defines ethnicity is a human group that entertains a subjective belief in their common descent because of similarities of the physical type or of customs or both, or because of memories, colonization, migration. These beliefs must be important for group formation. Furthermore, it does not matter whether an objective blood relationship exists. So the emphasis that Max Weber is giving here to an ethnicity is that it's based on the belief, right? Ethnicity, in a sense, what he is arguing is that it's a consciousness. It's an issue of consciousness, not purely physical genetics, which is what the definition of races, right? It's human groups that have a common genetic descent. But what's more important for an ethnicity is the belief. Even if it's untrue or not, it's being able to accept, in a sense, more of a spiritual or cosmic root of the group. Now, remember, throughout history, groups don't operate racially. They operate ethnically. Nobody was walking around with a DNA test, a cotton swab, to test people's DNA. They had common roots, common history, and obviously other people were adopted into the group, but they took on that group. They were adopted. Literally, like if I adopt a child, my wife and I adopt a child, even if he's not racially related to us, he's going to be raised like us with our values. And of course, there is something to be said about the body. There are differences, of course. We are a soul and a body, but the soul is of higher importance. It's higher in the hierarchy. And that's an important concept to understand when you're thinking about Hispanos. Let me give you one other definition by a Russian ethnosociologist named Sergei Shorikogovich. He says, an ethnicity is a human group that speaks the same language, recognizes common descent, shares common customs that are stored, transmitted, and sanctified by tradition, capital T, that distinguish this group from all others. So, it's about consciousness, it's about belief, but one concept he introduces is a capital T tradition, which all of us in here, whether we're practicing Catholics, whether of the Roman variety, of the Eastern variety, even if we're not, even if we're evangelical or Protestant or atheist, we all understand that the Catholic tradition, the universal tradition of Christ, is what informs our culture and identity before anything else. Without that, there would be no Hispanos or Latinos. There wouldn't even be Spain, right? It is the first thing that formed. And us who speak Spanish, we know what's the saying, primero Dios. So what I propose, and it's not, again, I'm not the inventor of this. I'm just typing it for people, that there's three roots that informs us as Hispanos in the Americas. The first root is Cristo Rey, right? It is a recognition of logos, of order, of natural law, of the Tao, of the way, of there is something beyond us that informs how this whole thing should go. And Christ is that logos incarnate. He is the way. And that's what informed us first. So that's our first root, right? It's there's a literal concept to it, and there's an expansive concept to it too. I hope we all understand that. Second root is what I call our paternal root. So first you have God, then you have your father. Because here's the fact, whether people like to overlook this or not, we existed to some great extent before our father did his thing inside of our mother, right? We came out of our fathers. We are our fathers. Our fathers give us our sex chromosome. So before the seed is planted in the soil, the seed already existed. We are our father's seed. So our paternal root, and again, you could take this literally genetic, but that's not really the most important. We have to understand that even if you don't have Spanish blood, our paternal father of our culture comes from Spain. It is the Spanish language. It is who introduced the cross to our mother of whatever color, shade, or race she is. Again, I'm speaking here metaphorically. And again, let me go into the third root now. The third root is el mestizaje. This is the trinity of being an Hispano. So God, your father, and your mother. Without these things, you don't exist. Without these things, we don't exist. And just because my mother is lower on the hierarchy than my father, that doesn't mean that my mother is unnecessary or unimportant in the formation and creation of me. So el mestizaje is something that takes different forms in different parts of Latin America. The mestizaje of Mexico is different from the mestizaje of Hispaniola, which is different from Peru, which is different from the one in Argentina. Right? We get it. There was native nations that our ancestors came from, and they were very different in different parts of the world and in parts of the empire. And in some parts of the empire, they weren't even native to it, like in the Antillas or in the case of Argentina, where el mestizaje occurred more with other Europeans. But what's the thing that unites Mexico, Peru, Argentina, Dominican Republic? It's the fact that we all have the same paternal root. We are all half brothers. And whether we accept this thing or not, we're more related to our father's children than we are to our mother's children. That might be a stretch for some. We can expand on it later. But the point is that our fathers is where we originate from. Now, again, to present the Trinity, God, our father, and our mother. That is where we come from. And we may have slightly different mothers, but we're still all brothers and sisters in this continent. We are all still children of, you know, that man. So, with that, I'd like to open it up to you guys. Who wants to go first?
I think we need to highlight the nature of our Baroque Catholic and character, and that's why you highlight the Cristo Rey as the first root of our identity, because that's basically what structures the rest of it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Without that, everything else, first off, wouldn't happen, and everything else would be meaningless. Dios primero. I mean, what does an Hispano say when they say they're going to go do something, you know, perhaps with a big reward or risky or a plan that they might have? Dios primero, right? Dios prestante. Ojalá. What break down ojalá for me?
Yeah, from that
from the Arabic.
Yeah, from the Arabic. Que Dios lo quiera, yeah.
God willing.
And he's precisely a type of Christianity, which is the Baroque type of Christianity.
Yeah.
And that Christianity is una marca hispánica, is a Hispanic mark. And the Mexican character,
especially the Mexican macho, the Dominican man, the Latin American man.
We all that archetypal father who's a farmer, wears a variation of a cowboy hat and works in the land.
We still have that.
And that's why we're still alive.
In the dramas of telenovelas, there is that dramatic nature of the Baroque that we still maintain.
he's usually the handsome hunk. He's kind of like the underdog. Like, yeah, there's a guy who had more money, but he's the guy who like can wrestle a fucking pig and ride a horse, and you know, he's the knight.
No, exactly. And the sacralization of our life is also an important aspect.
Yeah, and
of that Baroque nature we have.
I thought that's why I share Sherikogovich's definition, because he puts the sacred at the center. It's the sacred that first brings us together in a matrix or in a system that bears the best fruit. And we are an evidence of that, that even though we kind of rejected something and we've gone astray, and maybe there was good reasons for it and maybe there wasn't, it doesn't matter. We're here now and in a subjugated position, even though we're the dominant population of these continents, we're in a subjugated position.
The thing is, we have the idea of that because we're Dominicans, we rejected, because we're Mexicans, or because we're or Nicaraguans, we rejected Hispanidad. There is a rupture between Dominican and and the Hispanidad, or the national rupture between the nationality and Hispanidad.
Yeah,
but that also happened in Spain.
Yep,
Spain also suffered from that rupture.
Yeah, totally. I think it's retarded when people think that Spain, the modern nation state of Spain, is what conquered the Americans and held the empire. No, Spain is just another republicette, is another piece of that empire, but it's not.
The thing is, in some aspects, precisely because we maintain those three roots purely.
Yeah, you see, that's exactly
We're more Hispanics than them.
Yes, I think that can definitely be argued. Because of the situation we've lived in for 200 years, you almost don't have a choice but to hold on to your piety, because how else can you deal with the world when there is no refuge, when you know deep down inside you're in a worse situation than perhaps you were yesterday, but maybe you can't consciously understand that. We've clung on to our faith and our religion. And it's really interesting, because from the very beginning of the colonization period, you had a tension within the churchmen. There was churchmen who really wanted to go all out and allow from very early on the Indians to basically open up a seminary for them. And there was churchmen who didn't want to, because they were afraid that the Indians were going to learn more about the faith than them, which is, I think, a really interesting chapter of the history to expand on. But the point is that even if you go today to Hispanoamerica, the more Indian you are, the darker your skin, the more likely, the more pious and traditional you are, the more likely you come from a family with more than one or two kids, right? The more likely you're closer to the land and nature. These are the last holdouts of this Hispanidad. And isn't that ironic that the ones who are least Español are the most Hispano?
No, yeah. No, definitely. Definitely. And I think with that sense of the Christian nature of Hispanidad, I think also there is this like sort of this sociological experience of life, of how do we experience life against, for example, the Anglo, right? So there's always this phrase, el protestante vive para trabajar, y el hispano vive, y el católico trabaja para vivir, right? You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
So it's a different conception of
life. It's a different worldview. It's a very different worldview. And that goes into how you treat things. You know, that goes into how you look at the planet or you look at the animals. I mean, from the very beginning, no matter how racist or white supremacist the Spanish were, they thought that these other people were equal enough to be their wives, carry their last names, and then have their children carry his last name. Because he viewed that no matter how uncivilized this being is still made in the image and likeness of my God. Whereas the Protestant didn't have that. The Protestant, because he's kind of semi-Judaic, is kind of where Adam and their Goyim. We are the chosen people, and everyone else is kind of a subhuman. And so you treat the world that way. And if you look at, go to flip your globe on your desk and put your finger somewhere in Latin America. Look at that town. Type it into Google, and then tell me what the prettiest thing you'll spot. The first thing you spot is the church in that town square. I mean, the town square, the cities of Hispanoamérica show that order, show that harmony. You know, it goes back to the Baroque essence you're speaking on. But these things were built 400 or 500 years ago, and they're still standing. And better than the things that were built 100 years ago. More beautiful. More the expression there, because the people of that time had a worldview. And we still have remnants of that worldview, de facto. We have them without thinking, right? It's not a conscious thing. That's the thing about ethnic identities, that though it is a matter of consciousness, it's not a conscious consciousness. It's just a default way of being. It's just what you rolled into. But the point is that...
You know what?
Let me just wrap up this point. The point is that our ancestors, when they were introduced to faith, both the Spanish, the Indian, and the African, and anyone else who came to the party and got rolled in, is that these people had a worldview that was harmonious, that recognized divinity, and that put that at the center of all things. And it's like you said, it understood life as a gift to gain a greater life. Okay, now it's getting real theological. To gain a greater life, as opposed to gain as much as possible in this life, which is how Anglo-America developed, and we're seeing what that line of thinking leads to. Yes, you will accumulate more wealth and power, earthly wealth and power, but at the end it will be for naught. Whereas you put God first, you may not have the most materially luxurious life, but you'll have the things that matter. You'll have the things that money cannot buy, that only God can grant. And life is sweeter when you live that way. Which is why when you go to Latin America, after being in Anglo-America, what do you notice? People are just relaxed. There's no one's wound up. No one's uptight. All the neighbors know each other. All the neighbors make a procession every night in the neighborhood and talk to each other about what's going on. You have ethnos. You have community. You don't have that here. You have business partners. Please, Taco, yeah. Go ahead.
So I wanted to quote from Raza Cosmica, and this is the third part of his thesis here, and it's when he goes into the spiritual aspects of our race. And I'm just going to read from it in Spanish. I was trying to Google Translate it, but it's not letting me copy this.
Read it in Spanish, but let me explain something real quick, because you said the word race, and that's going to confuse the American mind.
Oh, okay, well, the Iberoamericano, because he is talking about raza.
But we'll
use ethnicity.
Right, and that's what he means by raza. Yeah, he is speaking on the physical component of it, but raza is really more of a spiritual understanding. Again, when a Spanish, you know, when you ask Cortez what is his raza, he wasn't going to say white European, he was going to say español, a Swede or Castellano or a Swede wasn't of his same race, right? So raza in this context does not mean American race. It means more of ethnoi. Please go ahead.
Right. Thank you for that. Yes. So, Jesucristo, el autor del mayor movimiento
de la historia, el que anunció el amor de todos los hombres. Este amor será uno de los dogmas fundamentales de la quinta raza que ha de producirse en América. El cristianismo liberta y engendra vida porque contiene revelación universal, no nacional. Por eso tuvieron que rechazarlo los propios judíos que no se decidieron a comulgar con los gentiles. Pero la América es la patria de la gentilidad, la verdadera tierra de promisión cristiana. Si nuestra raza se muestra indigna de este suelo consagrado, si llega a faltarle el amor, si verá suplantada por pueblos más capaces de realizar la misión fatal de aquellas tierras, la misión de servir de asiento a una humanidad hecha de todas las naciones y todas las estirpes, la biótica que el progreso del mundo impone a la América de origen hispánico, no es un credo rival que frente al adversario dice te supero o me basto, sino una ansia infinita de integración y de totalidad que por lo mismo invoca universo, la infinitud de su anhelo, la segura fuerza para combatir el credo exclusivista del bando enemigo y confianza en la victoria que siempre corresponde a los gentiles. El peligro más bien está en que nos ocurra a nosotros lo que a la mayoría de los hebreos que por no hacerse gentiles perdieron la gracia originada en su seno. Así ocurría si no sabemos ofrecer hogar y fraternidad a todos los hombres.
Wow.
Entonces otro pueblo servirá de eje.
Wow.
Alguna otra lengua será el vehículo, pero ya nadie puede contener la fusión de las gentes. La aparición de la quinta era del mundo, la era de la universalidad y el sentimiento cósmico.
Yeah, man. Oh, this is very deep. And, you know, for those of us in English who don't understand the Spanish, he's basically saying that Jesus Christ came to speak of a love, a universal love. And because of this Jewish supremacy that the Jews had, that they did not want to mix with the Gentiles. And they did not want to be associated with the Gentiles. They rejected Christ. They rejected the universality of man. And they still do today elevate themselves as the chosen. And the rest of us, like you said, are goyim. And he's basically saying that, you know, this land is the promised land for the land that was promised by the Lord.
Wow.
And, you know, if we fail to, you know, live up to our mission here, that another group, another people, another ethnicity, another race would overtake us, they would take on that mission. Like, we would fail in the mission that God granted us. And it's very deep. And when we get to, like, part of, like, mestizaje and the yeah. third roots, I will. I have some other quotes that I actually managed to get copied into Google Translate, you know, quickly to put in English. But you know, feel free for anyone to chime in on that to see what Vasconcelos was talking about.
You know, I haven't actually read Vasconcelos, but I've noticed something. Like Moses' generation was led to the desert for 40 years. Basically, the last 200 years have been that for us. So we got to see what we did wrong. Wow. You know, and we know we did wrong. We rejected, you know, Christ our Lord, of course. and give in to pleasures and other things that the other people were offering. You know, we were chasing the things of the devil. But, you know, it's time to ride the ship.
Right.
And willing get finally get out of the desert.
Wow. And to continue with Vasconcelos, I think Rancho talks about the Hispano moment, and Vasconcelos talked about that civilization is going to come back to the Mediterranean, and we're sort of that continuation, and we're sort of this new Mediterranean, this new tropical civilization.
Yeah,
Hispano. He talked about the Hispano moment 100 years before we're talking about it.
Ooh.
He predicted it.
Yeah, man. Vibes in there. It's all very Old Testament, is what I'm seeing as a thread throughout the conversation. You know, to touch on the point of the Mediterranean, we are the Mediterranean. I mean, a bunch of us look Mediterranean. So Hispanoamerica was not just Spain. It was Portugal. It was Greece. It was Italy. Ireland came to the party. Germans came to the party. It wasn't just Spanish. Columbus was from Genoa. You know, some of the biggest conquistadors, some of the greatest minds, not even just military, but also ecclesiastical, cultural, were from these other countries. And all these countries came from the Mediterranean. And here's a connection that needs to be understood, that when I give the three roots of Cristo Rey, la lengua española, y el mestizaje, this is also the same roots of Spain itself. It's just a little different. So it's Cristo Rey, es la lengua latina, Latin, and el mestizaje. They too are a product of mestizaje. Now, it's not as distant as African, Indian, and European, or sub-Saharan African, Indian, and European, but it's still a mestizaje. You had Phoenician, Semitic. You have Proto-European. This is Proto-European. This is before Europe. You had Celtic. You had Roman. You had Moorish, Visigothic. So our identity works in parallel with the identity of the seed itself. And what you realize is that Spain is the inheritor of the Roman legacy, especially on the Western half, in the Western world, geographically, which is where we come from. We are the inheritors of the Roman legacy in the West, genetically and culturally. The Romans programmed essentially the same way as the Spaniards. They came to your lands, they beat you in a fight, and they basically forced you to be an intern in the company and work for free. But while you're an intern, you're going to learn some skills, you're going to level up, and maybe one day you can even be CEO of the company, which is de facto what happened. So who's to say that after maybe another 200 years of the Spanish Empire, maybe there would have been a Peruvian king or emperor? We don't know that. We'll never know that. But the point is that the Spanish are the inheritors of that Roman legacy. Go ahead, Alex.
Yeah, and you know, and here, that was the main ideology of the Spanish Empire, that they were a restoration of Rome. Remember, for 700 years, they fought the Muslims to hold on to their Roman religion and Roman language, which became Castilian. After, no coincidence, the year, and you said this in one of your podcasts, and it's true, the year they threw out the Muslims and the Jewish invaders, what happened? They discovered the New World, the Americas, and extended their line over there. Also, what happened in 1492, Spain intervened in Italy. Why they intervened in Italy? Because they viewed Italia as part of their patria romana. Okay? So while Spain was expanding the Americas, they were expanding in Europe too. So they were trying to unite. They were basically making the flag of the Caesars fly on four or five different continents. So just think about it. These guys, for 700 years, did not bow down to the Muslims, fought them, drove them from their land, and they were rewarded with this glorious empire, a civilization. They came over to the Americas. What did they do? Exactly what the Romans did in Iberia. Once they won the wars, they Hispanicized these people. They mixed in with these people. And, you know, talking about Spain, the best of the Spaniards went to the Americas. These were the guys who fought in the Tercios. These were the guys who fought in the wars. When the wars were over, they were given land grants in the Americas. So our forefathers from Spain, they were the cream of the Spanish. They were the tough. They had a little macho. I mean, these are guys who, in their lifetime, beat the French, beat the Dutch, beat the English, beat the Germans, beat the Turks. They beat everybody. And then they came over and married these beautiful Indian women, beautiful African women. We're their offsprings, and we should be proud of that.
Amen.
Yeah, Alex, and, you know, what, like you said, that they were gifted. They, Vasconcelos, you know, constantly the theme of, you know, Raza Cosmica is that this land was the promised land, like in the quote that I just read, and it was gifted by God for us to fulfill a mission. And I wanted to read one part about the mixing of races in accordance to this mission and guided by Christianity and the universal love, is that a mixture of races consummated in accordance with the law of social comfort, sympathy, and beauty will lead to the formation of a type infinitely superior to all that have ever existed. The crossing of opposites according to the Mendelian law of inheritance will produce discontinuous and highly complex variations as the elements of the human race are multiple and diverse. And so what he's really saying here is that we need this Christos Rei, the Logos, as our guiding principle and force for our mestizaje.
Yeah. So
if we fall into the trap of the mestizaje that's promoted today's culture by the media and by the globalist institutions.
Let's call it the godless mestizaje.
Biodeterminist, and he calls it the Mendelian law of inheritance, right? Which is completely driven by lust and vice and nothing more of any spiritual essence. He says it produces a discontinuous and highly complex variation because of all these differences that we have biologically, culturally, and so forth. But the fact that we had this unifying ethnic and spiritual connection in the Hispanoamericas allowed us to develop into an empire. Yeah. And when that was broken by the Masonic revolutions and the Republicans, that's why we see the way our countries are today. And then that's why the, you know, the
Anglos
and the Nords, they LARP about, you know, La Criatura de las Americas and all that shit.
Right, they try to denigrate us. And deracinate us.
We've fallen away from it.
Yeah.
Right, but for like the last 200 years, our mestizaje hasn't been guided by the...
It's almost like we're a product of a divorce that happened unnaturally and unjustifiably.
Yeah.
It's like your nosy Anglo neighbor got in somebody's head and caused the family to break up. And every family has their drama. Whose family doesn't have their drama? But it's your family's drama, and you deal with it within your family. And that's something that we haven't done, and it's only fed our enemies. But I think it's so interesting to hear that quote you read, because basically what he's saying is that if you truly adopt Christ's message, then mestizaje is a natural outcome. But it's a certain type of mestizaje, and that's an important distinction to make, that our mestizaje is a righteous mestizaje, is a mestizaje done God's way. Whereas their mestizaje is a Babylonian mestizaje that happens as a result of drunkenness and orgy.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. And like he goes on to say that as soon as education and welfare spread, there will no longer be a danger of the most opposite types mixing. The unions will be made according to the singular law of the third period, the law of sympathy refined by the sense of beauty. A true sympathy, and not the false one that necessity and ignorance impose on us today.
Wow.
Sincerely passionate joints, easily undone in the event of a mistake, will produce neat and beautiful stems. The entire species will change its physical type and temperament,
the superior instincts will prevail, and the elements of beauty which today are distributed among the different peoples will endure, as in happy synthesis.
Damn.
It's exactly what you were saying, bro.
Damn. That what is it that Franco said about mestizos? Angelo, are you on the line?
I don't know if it was Franco, but it was someone in the Spanish authority. They said it gives them a hybrid vigor.
A hybrid vigor. That's intimidating, man. And I think I don't want to make this too much about the body, though. Of course, it's important. You can't live without your body. But there's something higher than the body, and that's the spirit and the soul. And what we have to understand is that these embracing these three roots doesn't mean that somebody who's full-blooded European from Argentina, or somebody who's full-blooded African from El Chocó, or someone who's pure-blooded Indian from Guatemala can't also absorb and embrace this identity, because we're talking culturally here. Again, remember, let's go back to the definition, and the most important aspect of ethnicity is a belief. So what we mean by that is again, we speak Spanish, we have the faith through our father. We wouldn't have this faith. This is the faith of our fathers, whether he's genetically our father or culturally our father. It's like in the example I gave, if my wife and I adopted a child who's not racially genetically related to us, my father and my grandfather are still that child's father and grandfather as well, or great-grandfather, because he's been adopted by me. He has absorbed my ancestors. And who had a habit of adopting as almost like a social institution? Does anybody know what group of people in the ancient Mediterranean had that habit? It's the Romans. That was part of what they did. They adopted people. When they didn't have heirs, they adopted nephews or even people who weren't related to them to carry on their legacy and carry on their name. And so we as Hispanos, as product of these three roots, have to understand the legacy. And I'm really talking to men here, because the legacy is the baton that's being passed on to you. And that legacy that has been passed on to us through the Spanish Empire is the Roman legacy and the Christianized Roman legacy. That's our legacy to carry on. And so we need to step up and man up and stand up to the plate and the challenge right now, which is big, but is fitting.
Yeah.
But is fitting for men of a hybrid vigor.
Yeah. So I got one more. That leads right in from where you just said, right?
Go ahead.
Each rising race needs to constitute its own philosophy. The Deus ex machina. We have been brought up under the humiliating influence of a philosophy devised by our enemies, if you will, in a sincere way, but with the purpose of exalting their own ends and nullifying ours. In this way, we ourselves have come to believe in the inferiority of the mestizo, in the irredemption of the Indian, in the condemnation of the negro, in the irreparable decline of the Oriental. And, you know, he's basically saying it's that, like you said, that jam dialectic, that jam culture, the Masonic influences in our nations, taking us away from our Christian faith, our fathers, culturally and biologically, has put us under their dominion. And that's like the Monroe Doctrine, I believe, is it not? That, you know, the United States, the Masonic powers, have total dominion over all of Hispanoamerica. And if the European powers were to intervene here, that they would go to war, because this is their Masonic domain.
This is their backyard. We are their backyard.
Their backyard.
And it's funny to me.
The manifest.
These Latinxers who come from their backyard are trying to be accepted by the house. The Latinxer is the house Negro of Hispanidad.
You know, it's funny you mentioned that, because on the stream just now, not to like bring it off the subject, but you know, Radical Latino was saying that he was shitting on working class people, saying, oh, why don't they pool their money together to give this money to politicians to support our interests? So on the one hand, he's calling the U.S. system a white supremacist system, but he wants to give money to the same white supremacist system so that maybe they can get something back. And I think Malcolm X said a quote that if you have to beg a man to be free, you'll never have it.
Real talk.
You know, that you don't have to beg a man to be free, because freedom comes natural. Either you have it or you don't. And, you know, they are basically, like you said, they're being the house Hispano, the house Negro, the house Latino for this system, because he can't conceive of anything outside of it. He wants to still be a part of it. He wants all the, you know, the things that the satanic system has to offer him, the materialism, the comforts, yep, all the stuff.
Because he doesn't know himself. He doesn't know himself. He believes what his enemies have lied to him about, that he's a product of a rape, that his dad was a rapist, his dad, who's dead and no longer here, was a rapist, and that his mom was a dumb Indian who didn't know how to defend herself, or a poor black slave girl who, you know, had paradise back home.
Yeah, and that leads them to doubt their faith and abandon the faith. Yep. That gets them into these traps, these satanic traps, these lust.
Double down.
These American Masonic traps.
That's exactly right. Because it's the faith of the colonizer.
And this is just what I said to Paola today, was that, you know, I asked her if she adheres to critical theory, and she's like, yeah. And, you know, here he says that, you know, we are influenced by a philosophy. Again, critical theory is a philosophy devised by our enemies.
Yeah.
And I told her, you know, this philosophy that you adhere to is from the 1% that you are claiming you are against, and it's for their own purpose, of their own ends, and nullifying ours.
Yeah.
But she didn't get it. No. She couldn't get it. She got super offended and super emotional.
What was her response? Critical theory.
It was visceral.
It was made by a black woman. Well, last time I checked, Obama was technically black, but did that make a difference for black Americans? It didn't. So who gives a fuck what color you see again? The Anglo worldview makes it racial. It's telling you that if somebody looks like this, then they're your brother. But we all know that sometimes our friends are more brothers than our own blood-related family. So what's really important here? Who you're related to, or who truly loves you? Is the body more important than the soul and the spirit? It's not.
Yeah, and just to chime in, this Latinx ideology, in a weird way, is actually a form of Anglo-white supremacy. It's basically saying you're nothing. You're just a product of a rape. Your ancestors were evil white men from Europe. But then the Spaniards aren't white at the same time. You know, like, they play this double game with Spain. One minute the Spaniards are white, next minute they're not white because they're traitors to the white race because they mixed in with Indians and blacks. So these Latinxers are the best friends of the white supremacists. Why do you think Trump shits on Hispanics? Because he views us as weak. Why does he view us as weak? Because our spokesmen are either Latinxers like AOC, who's a dimbat, doesn't know her heritage, or pickneys like Ted Cruz.
Yep.
I would bet you that if we had strong Hispano spokesmen, Trump wouldn't be separating kids. He wouldn't be saying they're all rapists coming from the border. They wouldn't be running their mouths, because the one thing Anglos respect is strength.
Amen. Amen. And let's touch on that, because there's another thinker, ethno-sociologist named Lev Gumilev, who was a Soviet dissident, right? This guy came from kind of upper-class Russia before the Soviet Union, and then he was in jail like more than half of his time because the Soviets didn't like the shit he was saying. But Lev Gumilev was influenced by Shirokogovich, and Lev Gumilev, you know, he expands upon his upon Shirokogovich's thought, and he introduces things like the biosphere. So it's basically like the physical world, the biological world around you also has an influence on your ethnicity. It's not just religion. It's not just language. It's not just like these historic myths or ethos, but also the land does have an effect, right? So you could take a European who's Irish, Czech, Polish, Ukrainian, and Spanish in Argentina, and the land has an effect on these people. So that's a concept that Gumilev introduces. But the biggest concept he really introduces is the concept of the passionary. And he describes the passionary as a person who's basically like a fucking local, right? Like he puts something greater above himself over his own needs. So this person is kind of crazy. He uses the example of the biblical prophets, right? These were these kind of crazy guys in the Old Testament who like fucking called shit out, the wickedness in their people, and half of the time they were killed for it. But, you know, they suffered. They live aesthetic lives as passionaries. And what they did was they marked the border. They marked the line of the ethnos. And I look at people, and it's not necessarily a conscious thing, right? You look at people like Che Guevara or Fidel Castro, and you don't have to agree with their politics. I personally don't. But you see the Hispanidad. You see the passionary in these men. Even you could argue people like Escobar, right? Or you could think about Cortez or Tupac Amaru or Agualongo or, you know, Zapata or Sandino. You know, there's just all these men who, if you look at them now, understanding this concept from Gumilev, you realize like, wow, these men are passionaries. Even somebody like, ¿cómo que se llama el mexicano? Coño, se me fue la boca. Chalino, hueputa, no jodan ustedes, pensé que eran mexicanos. Chalino is a passionary. He re-Mexicanized the Pocho and the Chicano. You see, that's the effect that the passionary has. He marks the edge of the ethnos. He marks the border. He's a border collie.
People like Pancho Villa, yes, and Zapata también.
Exactly. I mentioned Zapata.
The Fernandez had a song too about that. He had a song.
Really? What song?
I forgot the name of it, but I'll link it in the chat right now. It's an old song.
Is it Lamberto Quintero?
Los Mandados.
Los Mandados? Por Vicente Fernandez. Okay. I'm gonna include it in the show.
I found it. There's another passionary, no?
Who?
Look, hey, I'm gonna link it right now.
Wait, Fonz, who'd you say?
Being Mexican or Hispanic in general, and how the U.S. is basically our land, and you know we shouldn't be illegal. It won't let me link it though.
Don't worry, I found it, and I'll include it when I cut up the show. I'll put it into. All right, good. Yeah, I'll put it in. Fonz, who did you say was another passionary? We didn't hear you.
Jesus Malverde.
Yeah, there's tons of these characters throughout. You know, some of them will be known more by our region or our nation states, but some of them are heroes to all of us, no matter where they're from. And, you know, let me take advantage here of dropping a quote from Che Guevara, which I think is really good. He said, "Even though we are too insignificant to be spokesmen for such a noble cause, we believe, and this journey has only confirmed this belief, that the division of America into unstable and illusory nations is a complete fiction. We are one single mestizo race from Mexico to the Magellan Straits. And so, in an attempt to free ourselves from narrow-minded provincialism, I propose a toast to Peru and to a united America." Che Guevara. Now, when he said mestizo race, again, you can take this literally, but because he's an Hispano, there's something before the physicality, literalness of things. There's a spiritual mestizaje that even if you're a negro from República Dominicana, a indio from Chiapas, or a blanco from Uruguay, you can still vibe. You can still connect. You'll still have more in touch with each other than someone of a separate ethnicity. You still dance to the same music. You can still understand metaphysical concepts together. See, these are the things that unite our soul. So even if genetically you don't have this admixture in you. Your spirit has it. Your soul has it. Our culture has it. So what I always try to propose, and it makes me enemies on the left and the right of this false dialectic, is that we embrace our mestizaje. We shouldn't be ashamed. Even if you're a Mexican with 2% African blood, I can't think of a Mexican that I know personally that I respect, which I know tons of them, hundreds of them, who's going to deny 2% of his blood. That 2% of his blood, if it wasn't there, he wouldn't be him. No matter what admixture we have, we should not be ashamed of it. Without it, we wouldn't be us. It's God-given. If you understand the first root of our culture, you automatically understand the third root of our culture. That's something that I've kind of picked up on our sharing today. But let me bring.
I got another quote for you from Che, and you know, honestly,
go ahead.
Coming from the right wing, right, man. You know, I never thought I would be quoting Che, but you know, I gotta respect, you know, respect where it's due, Che, right?
As
recognize real, right?
Exactly. Let's give credit to the African Americans before they think we're culturally appropriating them. Real recognizes real. And by the way, right. African-American friends of mine out there in the internet, if you can't recognize that I got a black soul somewhere inside me, then maybe you should question how black you are, because I got tons of niggas who can vouch for how black I am. And I mean African-American niggas. All right. Anyways, go ahead.
Yeah. So this is a fragment from a speech in the UN from 1964. And our girl, Alicia, posted it. So, you know, thanks to her. So. The moment it is necessary, I would be willing to give my life for the liberation of any of the countries of Latin America without asking anything of anyone, without demanding anything. And dude, he did. He did.
Amen.
He
walked that talk.
Yeah, he stood up to the empire.
And, you know, I think we can really make an episode out of the kind of communist, Soviet, old school, tanky, leftist figures of Latin America. It really does deserve its own episode. But you have to understand that even by very academic Marxists, Guevara is not seen as a Marxist. They call him a Guevarist. Because before he adopted this political language to express himself with, he was an ethno-nationalist. There's no doubt about it. So you can dress your packaging in left-wing propaganda and branding all day, but your worldview is right-wing as it gets.
And yeah, that, I mean, was pretty base. I'm not going to lie. Like, Che's pretty base, bro.
Same thing with Castro. You know, I have this video was shared with Fidel Castro talking about La Hispanidad.
No seríamos jamás respetados por los poderosos. No alcanzaríamos el bienestar al que aspiramos. No ocuparíamos un lugar en el mundo. Y por eso para nosotros los cubanos, estas cumbres que están teniendo lugar, tendrían una enorme importancia en la medida en que ayudaran a nuestra unidad. Y la obra histórica no estará concluida hasta que no estemos unidos. Sé que es una meta difícil, sé que es un camino largo, porque son muchos los que quieren que no nos unamos nunca para tenernos dominados, para tenernos avasallados. Y en esa lucha nuestro país ocupa, nuestro pueblo juega un rol fundamental, luchar. Resistir. Siempre quisieron apoderarse de Cuba los norteamericanos. Estamos defendiendo nuestra cultura de 5 siglos, nuestra identidad, nuestra sangre. No queremos ser otros. Queremos ser nosotros mismos. No queremos ser un Los Ángeles, donde cada día son más discriminados allí los hispanoamericanos, los negros, los humildes. Queremos ser, seguir siendo esta maravillosa mezcla de españoles, de indios y de africanos. Nos sentimos privilegiados por eso. Es lo que nos dio la historia. Es lo que nos dio Dios para los creyentes. Es lo que nos dio Santiago hace 2000 años.
Damn, bro.
Guys.
That made me want to cry.
That was a Spaniard speaking. Castro was channeling. When he says Santiago, I was expecting him to say Santiago de Sierra España. He was channeling his Spaniard self. In his mind, the United States is the old British Empire. That could have been a speech Philip II gave.
Oh, man.
When he says that we don't want to be anything else, we want to be ourselves, I don't know about you guys, but that it gives me this energy. It gives me hope, you know? It makes me want to do this, you know?
Makes me want to plant a seed.
It revs me up. Exactly.
And here's the thing. I'm very right-wing, and this speech moved me. Because to me, it was not a communist speech. It was an Hispano speech.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah, I never thought I could vibe with, you know, Castro, but hey.
Because the reality is that capitalism, communism is a false dialectic. Okay? And they both come from England. No coincidence there. Because the real intention is the synthesis of those things. Again, understanding the dialectic is fundamental if you want to continue in this course of Hispanization that we're all undertaking here. You really have to understand how dialectics work. Capitalism, communism is a false dialectic. Black and white is a false dialectic. And Hispanidad breaks those false dialectics for what they are, because they're fake. They're lies. You can't. Something based on a lie, no matter how elaborate it is, no matter how long you can get away with it, eventually will come back to itself. And what's based in a lie cannot compete with what's based in truth. And the truth in which our people, our ethnoi, is based is the truth, the light, and the way.
Dude, I got something for you. A good quote on that, exactly on what you were saying. One basic truth can be used as a foundation for a mountain of lies. And if we dig down deep enough in the mountain of lies and bring out that truth to set it on top of the mountain of lies, the entire mountain of lies will crumble under the weight of that one truth. And there is nothing more devastating to a structure of lies than the revelation of the truth upon which the structure of lies was built. Because the shock waves of the revelation of the truth reverberate and continue to reverberate throughout the earth for generations to follow, awakening even those people who had no desire to be awakened to the truth. Delamer Duveris. I don't know who that guy is, but that's one of the quotes at the beginning of Behold a Pale Horse by Milton William Cooper.
It's real interesting how this conversation has worked out. You know, I gave a quick introduction on the concepts of race and ethnicity, and then I dove into the three roots of our ethnicity in the hierarchy of those three roots. But once we unpacked the first root, it almost like made us jump straight to the third root. And it's real interesting, you know, how theological this concept is. You can't get away with it because it's a trinity, you know. There is a universalness of this, no doubt. But what's the bridge between the first and the third root? It is the second root. It is our paternal root. Our paternal root, as in a household, right? In my household, I am the father. I am the head of this house. I am the priest of this house. I am the security guard, and I am the provider of this house. And the key there is I'm the priest of this house. The souls of my wife and children are more my responsibility than their own. God has made me a steward over these people's lives. And I have to answer to him for their failures down the line, in as much as it had to do with my hand. And so if we understand that as men, regardless of our individual genetic makeup, then we can also understand how our Spanish root is our paternal root. And it is from the Spanish man, the conquistador, the charro, the llanero, the guajiro, el vaquero, el sabanero, como le llamen en tu país. Because all those men get their identity from those horsemen of Spain. And so,
yeah.
Again, if we understand this in our individual homes, then we can understand this in our national, capital N here, ethnoi nation, not nation state, but nation as in the nations from the biblical term. We understand how every one of these roots, except for maybe the first, can't function without the other. This is extremely theological. And there's no coincidence in that, because the men who provided the seed that created us physically and culturally were informed by that first truth. So,
you know, Vasconcelos says that we are, that the European was the bridge to this new era.
Yeah. And I'll take it. I want to expand on Vasconcelos. We should definitely have an episode on that book. I think it's fundamental and it definitely needs to be brought to this present moment. But, you know, I have an issue just off the top right there with the European, because now he's clumping Europeans. And the reality I know what he means. But again, a retard. What's that Haitian guy's name in Christina's live chats? Ricardo?
Yeah, Ricardo. Yeah.
He's going to get stuck on that. So let's just make it what it is. It's Spanish. It's from
Right, that's what he's talking about, the Iberian.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, the Iberian. España. Yeah. This predates the Spanish language. This predates Spain. España is the Roman name for the province that encompassed the Iberian Peninsula.
So, you know, he does say that the people here, you know, our third root, the people who were tied to this land, they're Atlantis, right? That they were the lost civilization of Atlantis. And when they had lost their civilization, Los Españoles, the Iberians came over, because, you know, the theory goes that the survivors of Atlantis went over into Egypt and the quote unquote old world, and Los Españoles brought back that civilization, that brotherly spirit, that Cristianismo,
that gentility,
brought that back to
that Baroqueness,
the lost continent. Yep, brought that back to the lost continents of Atlantis, and to bring back these civilizations that were lost to barbarism into the future.
Bring them back to God.
Bring them back to God, but into the future of, you know, the 21st century, if you want to say our times now, but the future of humanity.
In this moment.
Yeah. And I mean, even back then, they were still, you know, barely out of the Stone Age, even though they were advanced in their minds and in their, you know, concepts and understanding of astrology.
You mean like sociologically?
Yeah, sociologically, right. So like, you know, even then they were brought into modernity.
And I think one thing that needs to be understood is that the Northern Europeans, the ones who owned the copyright on white and Western, weren't that far ahead. I mean, just a couple hundred years before that, they were doing the same shit in a much less impressive fashion. They didn't build pyramids and they didn't have calendars that were more accurate than today's calendars. They were doing it to wood figures in the forest.
The Spaniards still viewed them as barbarians at the time of their empire.
That's important to understand. And if you understand, the ones that the Spaniards viewed as barbarians are the ones who own the copyright on white and Western. And I'm about letting them have it. I don't want to contest it. You can keep it. But those are the ones who say the Spanish aren't really white. And they're not really Western. They're kind of superstitious. They kind of hold on to this, you know, papish religion. This outdated religion from the Dark Ages. You see, the Dark Ages as a concept is a very jam concept. But one of the things you realize about Hispano society culture is that it's very medieval. It's very genteel. It's very Baroque. Till this day.
It's true what you say, because the Christianity that Hispanos follow is more of a pure form than what's here in the United States. Yep. What you hear in the United States, even the Catholic version of Christianity in the United States, is the based form. It's like based on the Reformation and the Age of Enlightenment, all these wacky ideas that actually conflict with Christianity. Because Christianity is not about color. It's like you said, it's a spiritual thing. It's a community, la cristianidad. And when I see these, like, Anglo-Americans talk about, we're a Christian, we love Jesus. Notice they don't say Jesus. They say Jesus. But then they'll be like, I hate those spicks and niggas. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know? And then they'll talk shit about Islam. Who stopped the Muslims? It was the Spaniards. Do you know who was the ally of the Ottoman Empire? The Dutch, the English, and the French. But somehow, we're the invaders. We're, you know, and it's like, they're not Christian. If you're a real Christian, you will love someone who worships Christ as your brother. Yes. You won't view him as another race. He's your brother. He's worshiping the cross. But they don't view us as their brothers because you know what? Their Christianity is a heresy. It is. It's a fake dialectic. It's a heresy. Henry VIII is where it all started. Then you had the Calvinists who were super heretic. I mean, the Calvinists make Henry VIII look Catholic, okay? And the United States with this Protestant work ethic is just so based on Calvinism, basically. And it's not Christianity. It's a racialist. It's like a racialist, almost a demonic thing. You know what I mean? Like they handle snakes and they go, Jesus will say you burn in hell. No, Jesus doesn't say that. Jesus, my Jesus no dice eso. Jesus traiga el amor para el mundo.
That's exactly right. It really comes back to Pentecost, man. I mean, when was the church founded? It was founded at Pentecost. When remember, there was all one race. And then Nimrod built the Tower of Babylon. And as a punishment, God destroyed the tower and or confused the tongues and nobody understood each other. And so they all fought each other and destroyed the tower. And through Christ manifested through Pentecost, all the different tongues came back together and spoke one. So without Christ as a centerpiece, without the tradition, without the sacred, without the first root, we do not function. And it is because of the first root that no matter how poor, downtrodden, beaten, victimized our people have been, we still have our chin up because we know God is in control. And by that virtue, we haven't been seduced. We're at that crossroads right now. We have the choice to make. Are we going to be seduced and go the white Anglo-Western way and then end up with their consequences, but even worse, because it'll be a broke version of it? Or do we want to forge ahead, staying close to God and his ways and his proper order and benefit from those fruits? That's a choice our people have to make right now. This generation has to, that is el momento hispano. It's a choice.
You know, I'll be honest with you. I wouldn't be surprised, you know, if this Hispanidad movement is what I think it's happening in the burgeons. And let's say 100 years from now becomes either the dominant ideology or the dominant power in the world. I wouldn't be surprised if most people who are now Anglo by that time period will be Hispanicized because they'll be drawn to something authentic and real. Yeah. And they'll realize that their ancestors were wrong and that we're the ones showing them the true Christian path. So I wouldn't be surprised if in 100 years, a lot of Anglos become Hispano.
I would agree. And I think one of the big conversations that's not talked about in American mainstream society is the Hispanization of the Anglo and even the African-American. But if you go to a place like Los Angeles, if you go to the Southwest, is where you see it the most, right? The cowboy is a perfect example. But even if you go to LA amongst, you know, black masculine men who grew up in the streets of dignity and of honor, you're going to see a lot of Hispanic idiosyncrasies in these men. This conversation has not had a lot. But I think what's crucial is that we have to expose that true choice, the jam or the Hispano. We have to offer that to the Anglo, whether he's a white Anglo or a black Anglo, because jam culture is bad. Heresies are bad. Lies are bad for all people, even those who benefit from them initially. And if these men see how this is a better route to take, then we've earned new allies. And this isn't about power plays or who's on top or who's running things or who gets to LARP as the tribe of Judah. This is about honoring and glorifying God. And let his will be done, not ours.
And we would all be one. Let's say 100 years from now that, you know, United States collapses, you have this Hispano superpower covering the continent. Those people who were formerly Anglos would be our brothers. They would be speaking our language, being our culture. I mean, like, for example, my fiance, she comes from the Anglo-American culture, but, you know, she's becoming Hispanicized. And she says what she's drawn. She says, you're like a man's man. Like, she says, I don't, you know, she's 30. She says, I don't meet that many white men that are men like you. Like she just says, I'm just so drawn to you because you're a man. And that says everything.
Exactly. It explains why our fertility rates are where they are. And this is like, our fertility rates are as low as they are because of jam culture. If jam culture didn't exist, our fertility rates would still be in the 6s and 7s. And by God, may it be his will, may this conversation we're having lead to an uptick in that number. May we form more strong, righteous, well-ordered Christian Hispano families. You had another quote from Vasconcelos, Taco. You want to bring it in?
He says,
"Hold up, bro. Wait, hold up. My bad. I know I wasn't seeing. I was listening, but I had a different example. I had a friend from Kentucky, and he moved down here to the South Texas when he was about 11." And at first, he was like this dorky gringo, and then he started hanging out with us, and he started saying our slang. He became a bit crazy, you know, and his name went from Sam to Weddle, you know, so like, we adopted him, you know. That's how it is out here. I mean, I remember there was this kid who was, he was a mulatto from Ohio or some shit, right, a biracial kid, and he came here, and he started using our slang, and he showed that, you know, that he can bang, and, you know, we started calling him Negro, you know, I mean, it's a cultural thing, you know, and people don't understand that because I mean, they grew up in Anglo America.
I had the same thing. Yeah. I had the same thing growing up in Redondo Beach in Inglewood. Right, I'm from Inglewood, but I went to high school in Redondo Beach, and we had a Serbian and a Polish guy in our clique or group, and they didn't identify as white. White to them was like suburban Protestant WASP with like access to things.
Yeah.
Whereas
you can notice, can notice that amongst the old school Mexicans. I mean, most of my family there, I mean, if you were to put them in a room with the Anglo person, you probably wouldn't tell the difference, but they would never ever call themselves white. They say they're Mexican, you know, or Hispanic.
Or those, my friends would say they're Polish or Serbian.
Yeah. We don't see that. You know, like, we don't see it like the way the Anglos do, or, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, that's exactly right. That's exactly right. Yeah. And we had a black friend too, Jamal. What's up, my nigga? Hopefully you listen to this shit, hit me up. And, you know, when we would go to like parties in Hispanic neighborhoods, we would say Jamal's Cuban and get him the Cuban pass, and he was welcomed just like any of us were. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, I think that's a big thing that's not discussed in the mainstream conversation, but it needs to be absorbed. I mean, even if you look at, again, I think the Mexican mafia, I use it as an example a lot because it just shows in a microcosm these macrocosmic truths about La Hispanidad. You know, mm-hmm. One of the original members, Pegleg Morgan, is Croatian in the Mexican mafia.
How yeah, those had Asians in Lame too.
Yep, they had Koreans, Filipinos, Japanese, African-American even, Samoans. Because before, yes, we understand these people don't have our Mexican blood, but they have the Mexican heart. They have exactly, Hispanic
yeah,
ties.
That's why, yeah. That's why I said when my friend from Kentucky, you know, he came down and he showed that he can do crazy shit, you know, like
he was down. Like,
we started to call him, all right, like, you're Mexican now. Like, you act like a Mexican now. Like,
you don't got to prove it anymore. You don't got to prove it anymore.
Very, very macho.
Yeah, amen. Amen. And,
I mean, that's all I have to say. I mean, I'll listen more, you know?
Yeah, yeah. No, I appreciate you for sharing that.
I actually knew some Latin kings who were Irish in New York. Wow. They were Irish Latin kings, dude. And they were, by the Boricuas, they were Latin kings, viewed them as...
And
they viewed them as their crazy white
boys. To go back to the second route.
Better. Then, Alex. Oh. I don't know if Alex, were you done?
Yeah. I was just saying that the Puerto Ricans, who were mostly Latin kings in New York, didn't view them any different. Like, they were just, you know, they were just crazy Irish boys down with the Latinos, you know?
Yeah. No, there's tons of examples like that. And they're not really talked about, which is interesting. And again, I think what's crucial for us is to offer La Hispanidad as a worldview choice, as a way of living. Because the truth is that this way, though it may not give you Gucci belt buckles, is going to give you three sons. And what's worth more to you, really?
Okay, so... here's the quote. I'm sorry for before my system's messing up, but the race, and by this he means civilization, the race most apt to divine and to impose such a law in life and in things that will be the mother race, the new era of civilization. Fortunately, such a gift, necessary to the fifth race, is possessed to a high degree by the mestizo people of the Ibero-American continent, people for whom beauty is the main reason for everything, a fine aesthetic sensitivity and a love of deep beauty, oblivious to all bastard interest and free from formal obstacles. All of this is necessary for the third period, impregnated with Christian aestheticism, that puts on the same ugliness, the redemptive touch of piety that lights a halo around of everything created. And that's what, you know, Alex was saying before, is that, you know, what we have is authentic. That's what we were speaking about before, that, you know, our civilization has something still, even though, you know, we've been under assault for 200 years. We have something authentic and real and beautiful. And it's that halo.
And which is even greater than that initial 300-year phase, right? Let's look at the 300 years as a pregnant woman. The 300 years of the Spanish Empire is a woman in gestation. And she gave birth, and as soon as the baby came out, it was some tough times. And that baby's daddy wasn't there. And he got sold a lot of lies by his father's enemy. And all the wealth that baby inherited, a lot of it was stolen. But now that baby is a grown man. And so it's up to us what we want to do with these facts of history. It's up to us to take what our father gave us and make something even better than what he ever got to see or enjoy. not just materially, but spiritually. Haniel, please.
Well, I wanted to talk about the relation of the second root of language, of the Spanish language. I think the Spanish language, el español se hizo español en América. You know what I mean? Because antes de eso era simplemente castellano, pero el español se hizo español en América. And with that being said, I think la hispanidad, la lengua española, the Spanish language is fundamental as a way to unite us. But at the same time, it shouldn't be reduced to that, because the Spanish always recognized the sort of the language diversity of our
indigenous
land.
Of our mothers.
Yeah, exactly. They did the same thing with the Italians in Naples. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Because they asked Philip II if he wanted to sort of castellanizar Naples, and he said no. Just as the same way he didn't do the same thing to the America's. Mexicans.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So it's sort of, Spanish is important, but it's not reducible to that. You know what I mean?
Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Our father wanted us to be bilingual. He didn't want us just to speak Spanish. Of course.
I want to say it's, the way, let's say, Philip II wouldn't, Spanish, well, like, he didn't force Spanish on Napoleon. You compare that to France, and over there, they don't, you know, they all speak French now in southern France. Before, I think when only 10% or something ridiculous like that actually spoke French or something like that?
That's right.
Yes, the French spoken came from Paris. They spoke Occitanian in the south, which the Occitanian language is close to Catalan and Northern Italian.
That's right. And Burgundian and from Brittany, there are so many dialects that because of the French Revolution were pretty much all ethnically cleansed from France. And that's exactly what happened because of our version of the French Revolution, which was a broke version of the French Revolution. All the diversity that the Spanish system preserved, especially under the Habsburgs, was wiped away by this Masonic pick-me elite.
No, it's the homonization that Jacobinism and the French Revolution implies. You know what I mean? It's just like this sort of that there is no recognition of hierarchies, of structures that are the French Revolutions do not allow structures between you and the state. It's just directly you and the state. You know what I mean?
Exactly. And that's what they tried to make. But one of the things I noticed when I was having a conversation with Bilal, what was the name of the show? The One Struggle Show. The Enlightenment was shoved down the throat of Hispanoamerica. But the Enlightenment came from the Reformation. So it's like you could shove the Enlightenment down the throat of Hispanoamerica, but there hasn't been a reformation. So it's like, it doesn't make sense, which is why it never worked down there. And now they're trying to catch the reformation up, but that's a subject for another episode, which is important to note. But the point is, the Enlightenment can never work in a place where the reformation hasn't worked, because it's not native from it.
They're basically trying to take us from a medieval view all the way to modern day view, which
that's exactly right. And you want
to, they're trying to do it fast too, you know, because it's to their benefit to get us as fucked up as they are.
Yeah, because let's look at the moment again. Let's talk about a momento hispano. Let's look at the moment here. We're talking about 700 million people, if you include Brazil, versus 150 million to 200 million. If you include Arabs and Persians as white. So let's be honest here. Let's be frank here. This is the situation. And again, that person on average is in his 50s. On average, we're in our 20s. That person in his 50s isn't going to have much more children. The person in his 20s is for sure has the opportunity to have children.
But yeah, I think some of these Anglo elites already know they fucked up, but they just, you know, they gotta go with it. They're riding the train all the way to the dynamite because they don't
know what else to do. They don't know what else to do. They don't. You see, the jam mind does not have the sacrament of confession. You see here, if you don't have a means to confess your fuck ups, you're stuck in a trap of trying to justify them with more fuck ups. Confession is a beautiful thing because it allows you to disconnect from your mistakes.
Yeah, of course, you ask God for forgiveness, but just, you know, that's what happens when you place money for God
as a god.
That's exactly. No, and that's the nature of Puritanism. You know what I mean? The nature, there's something beautiful about confession, that is repentance, that is the
contrition,
the forgiveness of the sins. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and that sin is also anger and resentment is a sin. Because mm-hmm. you're supposed
which
to love
is totally opposed to this sort of like new, I don't want to like, but yeah, it's sort of this opposed to this sort of this cancel culture that is in essence Puritan.
Yeah,
it's you know
just,
what I mean?
Yeah, it's just Puritan going on to its logical, Puritanism going to its logical conclusions.
Yep.
It's a heresy. It's a heresy.
Women's emotions. That's all it is, honestly.
Yeah.
Virtual signaling, bro. It's, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So I want to bring in here, basically, once we understand these concepts, right? Once we have a good understanding of primero Dios, después respeto a mi padre, porque es el que me dio el apellido. Yo vengo de mi padre. Y después alabar y darle gracias a Dios por mi madre. Sea quien sea mi madre. Once we understand these things, these three core roots of ourselves, then we begin to really see ourselves for what we are, which is the things that Chad was talking about. And even Cortez in his letters, you can see him understand this concept at a very early stage. But there's been many other people. We mentioned Franco and the Falangist. Again, all these people were defending something. And they were, in a sense, at the root, defending their family. And what is a nation but a family of families? When I say nation, capital N, biblical term, not nation state. A nation is a family of families. So you can look at the different countries of Spanish America as different tribes, perhaps. Or, you know, some of these countries are very big and they might have, you know, four or five regions within them. But these are the tribes that together make a nation. None of these are real nations in the biblical sense. They're sub-ethnicities at most. They're really more regional cultures, I would argue. But we are a united ethnoi that's, again, informed by these three roots. And without the first, the second doesn't operate. And without the second, the third doesn't operate. And it is because of the first and second that we can all embrace each other. And we can all go to each other's countries, or we can all live in each other's neighborhoods and fit right in. You know, you might be teased about your accent, but, you know, what are you going to be? Be a little bitch, tease back. That's part of our culture. We bust each other's balls. A sensitive Hispano to me is not an Hispano. You can't be Hispano and have thin skin. We express our affection for each other through jokes. You know, if you wear glasses, they'll call you El Bisco in your family. Because why? We don't want you to be sensitive about it. We don't want you to be a little bitch about it. We want you to laugh it off. We want you to embrace it. We want you to make it work for you. That unique mestizaje that you come from. In the context of this macro mestizaje that we all are born from.
No, yeah, absolutely. And I think that some problem that some people have is this sort of like fetishization of like small differences, you know what I mean? Or, and in addition to that, there's also the resentment that you talk about, that some people say that, oh, I went to this country and they made fun of my accent, you know what I mean? Because, you know, that's such a minimal.
You sound like a little bitch. Que llorón, que maricón, hombre. Los hombres no lloran. Dejate de mariconada. Deja de llorar. ¿Cuál es tu mierda? I mean, how many ways can I express this? We all have different accents here, but we all know those expressions. Stop being a little bitch. Is how an African American might say it in Ebonics. Yo, you're being a little bitch. Para la mariconada.
No, exactly.
It's just not us. It's us after we watch a fucking Anglo movie and we think, oh, maybe that's the way to live.
Yeah, I mean, that hypersensitivity is, I think, it's pretty alien to us.
It's not Hispano, man. You know, el negro, el que no ha escuchado MTV, who's not on Twitter, not on Instagram, who doesn't have a smartphone, whatever in Hispanoamérica, however mulatizado this negro is, he doesn't give a fuck as much as an African American if he's poor, because he knows that, hey, yo tengo sazón, papi, que el blanco no puede comprar. ¿Sí o no?
Es cierto.
Ese es el hispano, esa es la actitud hispana. Lo que yo tengo, tú no vas a comprar, blanquito. So deja tu babosada. Yeah, this concept of all these concepts that these people bring in are just foreign to our world. That's not the way we operate. There's no such thing as white privilege in Hispanoamérica. Porque el blanquito quizás tiene su escuela privada, papi, pero no tiene lo que yo tengo entre las piernas. Tú sabes. You know what I'm saying? It's like, stop.
Y ese blanquito, no blanquito puro, tiene un abuelo, abuela que era negro.
Claro que sí. O sea, nadie se deja, ni el más pobre se deja humillar del más rico en Hispanoamérica. Él sabe lo que él tiene que el otro no tiene. Y si tiene él menos que el otro, no tiene un resentimiento contra la vida o contra Dios por eso. Because maybe God didn't give you this material wealth, but he gave you something else. See, because we have Cristo Rey first. We can, it's like you said earlier, Haniel, how we deal with life. We're able to be satisfied with what we have. That's very medieval.
You can keep your Audi. You can keep your wife that doesn't love you, that you got by flaunting your wealth.
That I'll fucks stay with the gardener.
Me. But at the same time, I think we need to exactly. be...
Wait, wait, Haniel, let Juan finish.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, you can keep your Audi. You can keep the wife that doesn't love you, that only loves you for your material items, that loves you for your money. But, you know,
the Asian wife.
I'd rather go home to a wife and to a children that, you know, look forward to seeing me, that see me as this protector, as this provider. I'd prefer that to this, you know, that degeneracy that white man comes home to.
Yeah, no matter, you know, it's like you get to come to your house in Manhattan Beach, you know, to a wife who was also coming home at the same time from her career job, to a baby that's being babysitted by a Guatemalan and raised by a Guatemalan woman, while the gardener you hired lives in Compton, has a bigger house than you, square footage and land-wise, and has children who smile when they hear dad's car coming in, and have a wife that's waiting for him with a warm meal and a loving home and a loving embrace. What's worth more? Haniel, you wanted to say something, buddy?
No, I just think that sometimes there are aspects of the Hispanic character that they have a bad part and a good part. You know what I mean?
Sure, like all things. Because nobody's perfect. We're not ever going to say here that
no,
we're...
No, exactly. And the aspect of caudillismo, for example, we've we've had a bunch of caudillos that have been anarchists in nature. But at the same time, we have some caudillos and a lot of them that they just wanted to put order to that anarchy. You know what I mean? So,
yeah, and they were working with what they had.
Mm-hmm. And that's the same idea of that, like, anti-materialism of the Hispanic. You know what I mean?
Yes. Yes.
But sometimes we should we shouldn't, like, overly romanticize that aspect.
Yeah, I know what you're saying. I know what you're saying. You know, and for me personally, it's like when people assume that I have something against, like, Anglos racially, you know, or it's personal. It's like, no, it's just Anglo culture is rotten, and it's rotten because it cut itself off from the universal truth. And then it went into alchemy, mm-hmm. and then it invited a bunch of bankers in to finance its piratist empire. So it's not personal. It's just there's something culturally wrong with where you come from. But that doesn't mean that in my experience in the United States, there's not great things that I can absorb and emulate from Anglos. That's not to say that there's nothing salvageable from this. There is. And I think that's part of God's providence. Right? Like, one aspect of my personality that's for sure American is the hustle mentality. Every stone turned, there's a great opportunity behind it. And I feel as enabled to capitalize from it as someone born of a much higher class than me. See, there's nothing stopping me from that venturous spirit.
And that's precisely the third root. You know what I mean? The capacity.
Yes, sir.
To take stuff from the other that can be helpful for us. You know
it's
what I
like,
mean?
The problem is that
when
Mega
we get
Man
blind
did?
By, yeah.
Is that what Mega Man did? Or I don't know, man, the cartoon, or is there I don't know. There's a character in my head. Or is it an X-Man? Basically, this nigga would touch you and he would get your magic power.
We're talking about Rogue, the female, no?
I ain't no female, but sure. Didn't Mega Man do that shit too?
Oh, yeah. But he'd kill you first, no?
Yeah, my nigga. So he would kill you, and then he would take your power into his blaster.
Yeah, that's it.
Mega Man is an Hispano passionary. Go ahead, Haniel.
Hell yeah.
No, and I think that's the idea of because I think Hispanics in the U.S. should be the example to Hispanics in Latin American countries, you know?
Yeah, so put your power.
No, exactly. And if we appropriate the state of the United States as a political structure, you know what I mean?
Yes.
That is going to be an important thing for Latin America.
Wait. Say that last point again.
That if we appropriate the if we make a Latin American culture, if we Hispanize the United States and we culturally appropriate the structures of power in the United States, the division between Latin America, the division of Latin America and Anglo-America is not going to happen anymore. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I believe, just based on what I know, that Anglo-America would rather put a 9mm barrel into its mouth and pull the trigger before it lets itself be appropriated by Hispanos. I think it would rather self-destruct than ever Hispanicize. Officially. I don't know what you guys
but
think.
But still, there's still going to be the structure of the state. You know what I mean? And that's the important thing. Because,
but the state in of itself is rooted in false theology. I see that as a risk. It's rooted in Enlightenment ideals. It's not rooted in the medieval ideal.
Mm-hmm. The problem is that in the end, how the Enlightenment happened. You know what I mean? I don't think it's possible to go back to a pre-enlightenment legal system, for example.
Yeah, yeah, I understand what you're saying. I understand what you mean. And, you know, there are examples of civilizations going back thousands of years and kind of re-civilizing themselves along those lines. The time of Confucius in China was specifically about that. They basically, you know, were archaeologists who saw pieces of this ancient dynasty and they did their best to try to relive it.
I think another example would be Frederick II, HRE emperor in the 1100s. He went back to the Justinian Codex.
Yeah. So I think there are ways, and again, I'm not trying to throw the baby out with the bathwater. There are things of value to absorb from this experience.
Yeah, sure. You know, we've learned something in the past 1,000 years. You know, we'll keep the stuff that works. But, sure. You know,
exactly. That's the way for God. Including the last. Yeah, and I think
that's important. What you said is very important because we're talking sort of this going back to our imperial sense, which is our true sense.
Yes.
It's a post-state society, you know what I mean?
Yes. Yes, it is. Exactly. I mean, that's real interesting when you bring it there. Because, again, we can't go back in time, but we can take from what happened back in time of what's valuable and reform it to this moment. And I think this might be a segue into another episode, but one of the things you notice from our countries, especially the biggest ones, say Mexico, Colombia, Peru, Argentina, is this regionalism that's always into kind of, Mexico's probably the poster child of it, but I think Colombia's a close second, where these regions just don't fucking work with each other, not being dictated by the capital city. It's just a constant strife. And what you realize that is at the peak, the best form of the empire was, in a sense, a confederation, imperium of city-states, where much more regional autonomy was enjoyed by, say, the province of, you know, Nicaragua. I like to use Nicaragua. I'm from there. But if you notice the size of a country like Nicaragua or Ecuador, you realize, like, it's one plaza. It's one plaza to run. You know, it's not like, compare it to Mexico, which is a big example of it, where it's like, damn, who's controlling the plaza here? It's constantly changing. It's just really hard to have order because then, well, who's controlling? Is it the local strongman or is it the Mexican Yale boys from Mexico City with their helicopters?
Yeah, and that regionalism is very Catholic. And I think Spain is an example of that. You know what I mean?
At a microcosm, absolutely. I mean, the Spanish nations within Spain have been preserved to this day because of Catholicism. Unlike France, which those regionalisms were basically ethnically cleansed.
The problem is that, you know, that regionalism can easily degenerate itself. With the introduction of French Revolution ideas to separatism,
Sir, because you're not keeping the first root, which is what our friend, the Latinxer school teacher, basically wants. Without the first root, without this proper hierarchy in our ethnoi or in our households, everything falls apart. She wants matriarchy. She wants the rule of the single mother. But the rule of the single mother only can operate in a nanny state, in a satanic state, not in a Christian one.
You know, I could see, okay, talking about, you know, an Ibano, quote unquote, takeover of the United States, what I could see happening is this is what happened. The U.S. descends into like civil war, kind of like what we saw was going on with the BLM protests. You'll have on one side like the white nationalists, and then you'll have like the BLM types, and they'll be duking it out. There'll be anarchy. Meanwhile, the Hispano areas will start being patrolled by people we might call the gangs, but they might turn into militias, right?
Yep.
They would bring order, security, safety. And then what'll start happening is other angles will be like, yo, look at these guys. They're bringing security and safety. So these Hispano groups start extending their rule. a lot of Anglos would view them as liberators from the BLM and the white nationalists. That's the scenario I could see happening.
That's very powerful. I think there's a lot of truth in that assessment.
Well, I'll bring up what E. Michael Jones says. I like to use him a lot. He's a very intelligent man. He always says when the U.S. does balkanize, it's going to be like Yugoslavia. Ironically enough, how do you think about that, Noel?
Yeah, he breaks it down into religion. I forget what thinker, American thinker, he gets it from, the triple melting pot, where basically says after two generations, Americans are either Protestant, Jewish, or Catholic. Those are the real ethnic identities of America, which I think there's some truth to that. But I think it really boils down to a dialectic. It becomes not Protestant, Jewish, and Catholic, but Judeo-Protestant and Catholic. And I would take it a step further. It's gringo and Hispano is the real dialectic that it all comes down to. I would bring it to St. Augustine, to the city of man and the city of God, right? One puts God at the center, one puts man at the center. And for me, the difference is really gringo versus Hispano. And gringo is not a race, it's a spiritual condition.
Yeah.
No, yeah. And I think problem is that the system of America, the Anglo system, self, their internal struggle is the black question. You know what I mean?
Is the what?
Is the black question, the African-American question.
Expand on that.
Does the internal struggle that is always going to come back? Is there this subtle masochistic relation that white liberals have with themselves?
Yeah, what I mean? They're into freaky shit.
No, yeah, and I think that's a white thing.
Is that psychosis? What do you call that? It is a mental medical condition.
Some Anglo psychosis thing.
Neurosis.
And the nature, the thing is, Hispanos, when they enter into the picture, as you said, they delude and they reformulate. They have the potential to reformulate
the dialectic. Yes.
It seems like every James Edward III or whatever is, their dad is some kind of weird ass degenerate behind the doors. Then
he likes lady boys from Thailand, and he likes taking his wife to Mandingo parties.
Exactly.
But hey, they have money. Hey, the GDP and the IQ, bro. Have you seen my results?
Hey, isn't it the IQ chart? The only reason they're higher than us is because they include Jews?
Probably. I like to test my IQ. I bet you I'm a shit on a big
chunk. Oh, I know. I don't like you a shit on most Anglos.
And they're going to be like, oh, that's because you're white. Oh, now I'm white, bitch, huh?
I'm white past you. Right? White all of a sudden.
White when it's convenient. White when you're scared about your mistakes of the mistakes of your fathers. I wanted
like
to
you guys.
Yeah, go ahead.
Most Anglos are retards, dude. I mean, not all of them. You know, there's some very bright ones, but just the ones I've been around are fucking stupid.
Sure.
But like you, like what you joke about, the white Hispanic race warrior. Like you used to show this Mexican guy with red lights or something.
Right. This straight nopalero. Yeah, I mean, I wanted to touch on that because this neurosis, this anal retentive neurosis that happens in the Anglosphere that doesn't happen in Hispanoamerica. Because in Hispanoamerica, there is no, I think this is something that I hear myself bring up. It's about taboos. You create taboos. When you tell your daughter, you can't date a black guy, you can't date a black guy, you can't date a black guy, and you say it so much to the point where your daughter realizes, like, this isn't really about my dad looking out for me. This is really more about my dad having an insecurity. You better believe your daughter's going to get with a black guy because she smelled a weakness in you. She smelled an insecurity in you. And you can see this, you know, maybe you've dated a girl and you've been at a party and you've been in this kind of social situation and you kind of these dynamics play out. You know, if you have to cuff your woman, she ain't your woman. You know what I'm saying?
When Julius Caesar divorced his first wife, I forget exactly what her name was, and it was because, you know, there was a guy who creeped into this all-girls party dressed as a girl, and then people were gossiping, and he divorced her. And when she asked, like, why are you divorcing me? Like, I didn't do nothing to you. She's like, Caesar's wife must be above suspicion. Like, if I have to cuff you, girl, you ain't mine. Yeah. And when you have to tell your daughter and enforce these things on her, you create a taboo. You're only giving, you know, it's like you can really notice this with American teenagers who get drunk like crazy starting from 16 years old. But you go to Italy where there's no legal drinking age and there's no teen drunkenness problem.
Well, that goes back to Puritanism, man. You keep, you know, you deny women something and they're going to want to do
you're
it.
You're only making the temptation worse. And what you notice
you
is
make it a fetish.
In the Spanish Empire, and I got this from Antonio, I forget his name. I can share the notes, as a professor from Spain. They legalized a free black man marrying a Spanish woman in 1502. This is 10 years after Columbus came here. What does that do? Go ahead.
Yeah, because he served the army and it tenía calidad. You know what I'm saying? So therefore, he was an honorary Spaniard in their mind.
Yeah, he let's take it from the present moment. He showed he had a Mexican heart. And again, because we're not uptight people, we're not insecure people, go ahead, dog. Hey, man, more power to you. You got yourself an Hispana girl. Good for you, man. I hope it works out for you. I hope you can handle her. You know, I'm glad to include. I'm glad to include you in the bunch if you really live up to the way we are. I'm glad to embrace you as a brother, regardless of the texture of your hair or the color of your eyes, because the first root allows me to understand that there's something more important than this matter. It's the spirit. This is not what the Anglo world works like. The Anglo world works like the Judeo world. It works like Adam, sons of God, or whatever, and Goyim, cattle.
Bloodlines.
Which is why a slave in Spanish America could end up marrying a Spanish man, could end up suing a Spanish man. You know, slavery in Spanish America worked very differently from French and Anglo America, and even Portuguese America, because of the Anglo influence. Let's be honest here.
It was based on the Roman system.
That's exactly right. The African man and woman was seen as a human being in a tough spot. They're an intern. They got no experience. You can't come into a company with no experience and demand the CEO's job and pay. You don't know the program. You don't even know how to read and write yet. Why don't you take your time, learn the ropes. Let's see what happens in a couple years. The Romans had Spanish Empire emperors. They had Slavic emperors. They had Arabic emperors. They had Greek emperors. So why wouldn't the Spanish emperors or the Hispano emperors be of the same?
Yeah, for all you know, the guy who unifies the Hispano nation might be un negro.
That would be dope, man, because I'm tired of African American, Anglo, Negro, Black, Gringo imperialism. I'm tired of that shit in our Black brothers and sisters, just because they share a certain melanin percentage. How retarded and arbitrary is that?
I was talking about that in some previous podcasts, that the problem with the problem with Hispanics is that we're like this source of people for a bunch of weird American identities that want to have sort of ethnic imperialism towards us. You know what I mean? We have like the Native Americans that want to have the more native looking Latin Americas. Then you have the white Americans that want to get the castizos, quotation marks. And then you have the African Americans that want to get the Afro Latinos, quotation marks.
Yep. You see why it's I have to stay away from this system with a 100-foot pole, because these are all gringos that you just described. And what they're going to do is they're going to awake the Hispano consciousness, and we're going to do what we've been doing since Rome, which is kick ass.
Poking style.
Which is kick ass. Hey, go ahead, man. Go ahead and poke the bear. Wake the sleeping giant. Let's see whose roots are strongest. Let me get into some.
And we're going to end up. Go ahead. And we're going to end up with their women.
I don't even want their women, dog.
Too late for me.
Yeah, not wife material.
Yeah,
I don't mess around with, but
I went back to the motherlands and the fatherlands to get my wife, because I'm like, I don't even want a Latina from this fucking place. But hey, I'm not saying
I'm carrying out a messy salsa, you know.
I'm not saying that there isn't jewels in the rough. Go ahead. Sorry, I didn't hear you.
No, I said I'm carrying out a mestizazo over here, you know?
Mestizazo, yeah. I'm sorry, someone else said something too.
I said that I realized that this week that I don't want an Americanized Hispana. Fuck all of that.
It's too much, bro. It's too much to put up with.
There's no need for it. There's no need for that. Because there's a version that's younger than her and purer than her and prettier than her. And knows how to make a better rice than her, who isn't going to fucking debate you on every fucking thing, and who hasn't been brainwashed by Sex and the City. So let the hoes go. Go get yourself a nice girl back from the fatherland. You can bring her here. She'll love you to death. She'll give you beautiful children. She'll take care of your home, and she'll defend you with her life if she has to. I'm living proof of that.
Amen.
So let me touch on some conclusion points here as we kind of start landing the plane here. So one of the things that I want to give our audience, you know, that might be Hispano and maybe never really, like, you know, hasn't really had a cultural education. But, you know, for our white and our black audience, you have to don't try to understand Hispanos as a race, because we're not a race. We don't see the world through a racialist lens. We're an ethnos. We're an ethnoi, which is real, organic. That is how human history operates, through ethnois, not through races. Only a man who's been cut off from his ethnicity attaches himself to race. And it's a very subjective definition of race that's constantly changing. So again, understand, we are a multiracial, monocultural ethnicity. Doesn't matter what our racial makeup is. What matters most is what informs our ethnicity. And what informs our ethnicity are these three roots: Cristo Rey, Dios Primero, God First. The Spanish language, la lengua española, our paternal root. The Roman legacy. And el mestizaje, our mother, whether she's Indian, black, or European, or Asian, or whatever the heck, or Arabic, Lebanese, it doesn't matter. There's, the seed is so strong here. Quick side note here, it wouldn't matter what race of woman I married, even if she was Korean, my son would still be Nicaragüense. Even if she was Aboriginal, my hijo would still be Nicoya. When a Spaniard spoke of la raza, he didn't think he and a Swede were of the same race. He was referring to his ethnoi, just like Hispanos do today. Right? And we had a lot of quotes from Vasconcelos that supported that. Hispano is not mestizo from a racial definition, right? White people, when they think of mestizo, they think it means something very technical. They think it means 50% Indio, 50% white. But in Hispanoamérica, if you have green eyes and reddish hair, you'll still call yourself a mestizo. And if you look like you're, for all intents and purposes, black, you'll still call yourself a mestizo, because there's a spiritual, cultural mestizaje of which we're all a product of. White Hispanos don't see themselves as part of the white race. They see themselves as Hispanos of a light complexion. Güero, trigueño, chele, mono. I'm sure there's other ways of expressing the same complexion. When we talk about blanco or negro, we don't see those people as of a different race from us, from our countries. We see those people as a different complexion, perhaps. Which is why you go to a country like Colombia and say you're like one of those really rosy pink white people. There's like six different colors in Colombia. There's like blanco rosado, blanco trigueño, oliva, moreno, rojo. I mean, there's so much more variation than just black or white or Hispanic or Mexican like they do here. So yeah, those are the things I want to conclude with. I want people to understand ethnicity over race. I want us to understand what are the roots of our ethnicity, and for, you know, our neighbors on the continent to also understand the roots of our ethnicity, and how understanding these roots bring us together as a family of families, as a nation.
Yeah, just a final thought. My grandfather was from Spain, and he always told me, el negro boricua, el indio mexicano, tu hermano, no es el blanco gringo. And when we lived out in the suburbs, you know, we had El Salvadorians who mowed the lawn. My grandfather would talk to them more than he would talk to his white neighbors. And he said, esos son mi gente. Esos gringos no son mi gente. And he always raised me on that.
Amen.
No, yeah. And I think also, as a final thought, I think we need to protect the Hispanic identity from all of those groups that think that Hispanics are this like source of infinite people that they can gain more that they can gain more from them. And we shouldn't be like that.
Yeah. Yeah, we shouldn't be inputs to another man's machine.
Yes, exactly.
I mean, I want to agree on that our biggest enemy towards our Hispanic identity is not, well, it is an Anglo, but they're going to use Latinxer because the Anglos are too much of a pussy to tell us to our faces. So they're going to tell Latinxer, oh, your Hispanic identity is nothing but rape. And the Hispanic, the Latinxers, they're going to come to us and tell us that. You know, yeah. So
we need to knock the Latinxers the fuck out. Even if we go to jail,
they're going
to
be the ones
fuck it
telling us. The Anglos are too much for pussies to tell us.
Yeah, they are. They are. That's for sure. Yeah, we have to push against the Latinxer and the Pygmy because they're coming at us from different angles. And we shouldn't give a fuck if we got to go to jail for it. And the reality is we don't give a fuck. We're not bitches. There's more important shit in life than even my job. Prefiero morir parado que vivir arrodillado. Zapata. Say anything. All right, guys.
Yeah, I'll jump in.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yep, yep.
Hey, sorry, my mic wasn't working.
No worries.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to say that
okay, now everybody's, you know, wait.
We have this moment in time, you know, we're alive for this purpose to fulfill God's plan and his will, acting through our own individual lives, but also together. And hopefully we will rise to the occasion. You know, as long as we put God first, like we started out in the beginning of this podcast saying primero Dios, as long as we do that, I think we will be all right.
My thing is, I think you just gotta say no to the traps that are in this jam culture. I say that to the Hispano in America, because it's very easy to fall into these traps of, you know, drugs, alcohol, lust, stuff like that. It's very easy to fall into these and not be able to climb out. So what I think, as a Hispano, you just need to claim onto your roots, your, you know, God, like we talked about, our the three things that link us, and not these, you know, these fucking disgusting values that these people bring upon us, and turn our own people against us. If that makes sense.
Yeah, that break us apart into pieces, yeah. Into more pieces, not just racial, but then it becomes the different sexes, and it's an unending Marxist critique.
Yeah. That it gets us to hate each other, and it divides us, and we don't need that. We need to come together, because we need to realize that these dialectics, they're not for us. We don't fit into them.
Yeah.
So we can't fall into these traps that these people have.
That's exactly right. We have to reject it. I want to close off with a poem by a Nicaraguan Hispano passionary named Rubén Darío. It's a poem called A Roosevelt, to Roosevelt. And I'm going to read it in Spanish. And he wrote this in around the time of, the Spanish-American War. Es con voz de la Biblia, o verso de Walt Whitman, que habría que llegar hasta ti, cazador. Primitivo y moderno, sencillo y complicado, con un algo de Washington y un cuatro de Nimrod. Eres los Estados Unidos, eres el futuro invasor de la América ingenua que tiene sangre indígena, que aún reza a Jesucristo y aún habla en español. Eres soberbio y fuerte ejemplar de tu raza. Eres culto, eres hábil, te opones a Tolstoy. Y domando caballos o asesinando tigres, eres un Alejandro Nabucodonosor. Eres un profesor de energía, como dicen los locos de hoy. Crees que la vida es incendio, que el progreso es erupción, y donde pones las balas, el porvenir pones. No. Los Estados Unidos son potentes y grandes. Cuando ellos se estremecen, hay un hondo temblor que pasa por las vértebras enormes de los Andes. Si clamáis, se oye como el rugir del león. Ya Hugo a Grant le dijo, las estrellas son vuestras. Apenas brilla, alzándose el argentino sol, y la estrella chilena se levanta. Sois ricos. Juntáis al culto de Hércules el culto de Mamón, y alumbrando el camino de la fácil conquista, la libertad levanta su antorcha en Nueva York. Más la América nuestra, que tenía poetas desde los viejos tiempos de Netzahualcóyotl, que ha guardado las huellas de los pies del gran Baco, que el alfabeto pánico en un tiempo aprendió, que consultó los astros, que conoció la Atlántida, cuyo nombre nos llega resonando en Platón, que desde los remotos momentos de su vida vive de luz, de fuego, de perfume, de amor. La Inca del gran Montezuma, del Inca, la América fragante de Cristóbal Colón, la América católica, la América española, la América que dijo el noble Cuauhtémoc. Yo no estoy en un lecho de rosas. Esa América que tiembla de huracanes y que vive de amor. Hombres de ojos sajones y alma bárbara vive, y sueña, y ama, y vibra, y es la hija del sol. Tened cuidado, vive la América española. Hay mil cachorros sueltos del león español. Si necesitaría Roosevelt ser Dios mismo, el riflero terrible y el fuerte cazador, para poder tenernos en vuestras férreas garras. Y pues contáis con todo, falta una cosa: Dios. And with that, I want to wrap up today's episode. Thank you, everybody, for participating. Special shout out to all the audience and listeners out there. We appreciate you guys. Let's keep it going. Peace.
Voy a cantar un corrido de un amigo de mi tierra. Llamábase Valentín, que fue fusilado colgado en la sierra. No me quisiera acordar, era una tarde de invierno, cuando por su mala suerte cayó Valentín en manos del gobierno. El capitán le pregunta, ¿cuál es la gente que mandas? Son 800 soldados que tienen sitiada la hacienda de Holanda. El coronel le decía, ¿cuál es la gente que guías? Son 800 soldados que traen por la sierra Mariano Mejía. El general le decía, yo te concedo el indulto, pero me vas a decir cuál es el jurado, la causa que juzgo. Valentín, como era hombre, de nada les dio razón. Hombres de los que inventaron la revolución. ¡Ay, ay, ay! ¡Arriba los hombres! ¡Ah! Antes de llegar al cerro, Valentín quiso llorar. Madre mía de Guadalupe, por tu religión me van a matar. Vuela, vuela, palomita, para tenerse fortín. Estas son las mañanitas de un hombre valiente que fue.